died for our sins according to the scriptures. He was buried. He was raised on the third day according to the scriptures and then seen by many witnesses. And then what happened from there was those witnesses began to spread out and go into all sorts of different places and to announce the good news that Jesus Christ, who is God in human flesh, came to be a perfect sacrifice for our sins, to give us eternal life when we believe in him, but also to give us a better kind of life now. That it's not simply about, oh, we get this awesome kind of future thing that we wait for and everything here is just kind of, it's normal or whatever, but the real stuff happens later. No, God has a plan for you now. God wants something for you now. He wants a better life for you now. And all of the teachings of Jesus center dominantly on what God wants to do in our lives now, here, today, in this place, at this time. And there's always an eye towards the future and eternal life. But there is this ever-present need for us learning to have the heart of God. And so what we're doing is we're in a series called How to Have the Heart of God. And the very first week we looked at the fact that if we want to have the heart of God first, we must seek it. Jesus said, seek first the kingdom of God, and then all these things will be added to you. And then from there we began to explore what the heart of God looks like. And last week we talked about how to have the heart of God means having a heart for goodness. Goodness towards each other, expressing goodness towards God, worship toward God. And today we're going to take it a step further and examine how the heart of God for us, for his people, for those who believe, who have placed their faith in Jesus Christ, is actually a heart for growth. So if you have your Bibles, Mark chapter 4 is where we're going to be. So just kind of hold your hand there. But I want to begin with a question. And the question is this, and if you are the sermon note-taking kind of person, you'll notice that the fill-ins are going to be in kind of the major headings on the slides up there. So the first thing that I have for you, the first question I want to ask is this. What happens when, well, it's kind of hard to see, but what happens when private and internal become the standard for our commitment to having God's heart? What happens when private and internal become the standard for our having God's heart? And what that means very simply is this. A lot of people have this idea of, I will do all of my most important relationship with God when I'm by myself, when I'm off, when I can find maybe a quiet place and just kind of be, just shut out the world, shut out all of the people around me, shut out all of the distractions, just be by myself and just sort of have this inside, quiet kind of relationship with God. And while I would say that that's actually an important thing to have, that is not the most important way that we commit to God. God designed us to be a people, not simply a person. Okay, what are we doing here at this moment on this day of the week? We have gathered, the tribe essentially has gathered, and we are here together. We are not simply individuals who have kind of come from our own individual lives and decided to spend some time with a couple of other individuals. We come here because this is one of the primary expressions of how we do what we do as the people of God. And what you will find as you read through the Bible, as you read through the scriptures, is that over and over again, the most important work of spiritual development is done not away by yourself, but in community with the rest of the people of God. But so many of us want to just be by ourselves, want to go away, want to take a moment and just go be alone, and we think that's where the most important work happens. We make private by ourselves and just silent sort of internal relationship with God our main standard, but that's not what the scripture does. That is not what the scripture does. And here's what happens when we do that. We have a culture of impatience where me-centered desire becomes primary. We create a culture of impatience where me-centered desire becomes primary. And so what that means is very simply this. If I can't get by myself, we become impatient with other people. We become impatient with distractions, and we begin to get frustrated by all of the different communal expressions of the people of God that God has actually set up for our benefit. I just want to be by myself right now. And there are moments where that's fine and that's okay, but that is not the dominant way God designed you to grow and to live and to move and to have your being. God actually designed us to grow in community. But if we go off and we make it all about the private, make it all about the internal, what happens is we create a culture where we become impatient and where then it's all about me, because we're always pointing our arrows inward. Right? If I make it internal, if I make my relationship with God to be just an inside me sort of a thing, I'm pointing my attention inward. I'm pointing my arrows inside myself, and I am making it about what can I do to make me personally better and forget everyone else. We become me-centered. Here's another thing that happens. We experience an increasingly shrinking imagination. An experience of an increasingly shrinking imagination and creativity, which cause us then to believe less. See, what happens when you take a pot of water, put it on the stove, and begin to boil it down? Well, you begin to reduce the amount of water that's in that pot, right? What happens when you begin to reduce the life of your relationship with God and your commitment to your relationship with God to private and internal? Well, if you reduce it, it becomes reduced. Doesn't that make sense? This is a dominant problem in our cultures. It's what's called reductionistic thinking. It seeks to find the smallest, most clear expression of something, latch onto that and go, this is the truth, or this is the way it should be. But what happens when we do that is that we begin to have blinders to all of the other fine details and realities that should be associated with that, whatever that is. And our spirituality, unfortunately, in America, has taken a similar turn. We have reduced the way that we do our relationship with God to private and internal. And in reducing it, we have reduced our ability to believe God. We have reduced our imagination. We have reduced our creativity. Many of you will say things, well, I'm just not a creative person. I don't generate, I don't do art, I don't do music, I don't do acting, I don't do... Well, if you reduce creativity to art, then you have misunderstood creativity. Produce something. Some of you go and work in an office. You don't realize that you're actually producing things there. The creativity is involved there. Some of you work on a farm, and that is highly creative, productive work. We get produce out of that. If we reduce our understanding of creativity, of imagination, what will happen is we reduce our ability to believe. We begin to narrow our definitions, narrow our understanding, narrow our focus so far down that we begin to believe less and less. And that's very simply a problem for us, because God is amazing.
Amen.
God is powerful. God can accomplish more than we ever could think or imagine or hope or even desire on our own. And that requires... He sleeps and rises night and day, and the seed sprouts and grows. He knows not how. The earth produces by itself, first the blade, then the ear, then the full grain in the ear. But when the grain is ripe, at once he puts in the sickle, because the harvest has come. Mark chapter 4, 26-29. The seed of the kingdom, or the seed of God's heart being planted in us, has already been planted and is growing by or through the teaching and the work of Jesus Christ. So when we talk about this, reality of us being a people of growth and not a people of reduction, we begin where Jesus begins, and we talk about the seeds that God has planted through the teaching and the work of Jesus Christ. And it's not enough for us, once again, to be private and internal, to go off on our own, to be by ourselves, and really hope that we'll be able to, even with the Word of God. Now, that's an important thing to do from time to time, but if we make that about all that it is, by ourselves, alone somewhere with the Word, then we're going to miss the benefit of what the community of God's people has to offer in terms of looking at the Word, understanding the Word, coming to believe and trust in the Word of God. But Jesus, his teachings are going to be central. So that's why we're actually going through the parables of Jesus Christ when we're talking about having the heart of God. Because when we encounter what Jesus says in the parables, in these particular parables we're looking at in this series, what we are experiencing is the seeds being planted. So just through the simple act of the public reading of the scriptures, something has happened just now. And what has happened just now is the seed has been planted in your heart. To what shall we compare the kingdom, Jesus says? The kingdom of God is as if a man should scatter seed on the ground. He sleeps and rises night and day, and the seed sprouts and grows. He knows not how. The earth produces by itself, first the blade, then the ear, then the full grain in the ear, when the grain is ripe. At once he puts in the sickle, because the harvest has come. So something has happened in this encounter with this parable, is that we're beginning to get a view of what God's heart is for. And God's heart is for kingdom growth. Now, when we talk about growth, we can talk about it in all sorts of different ways. We can talk about our own personal, individual growth. Okay? That God wants me to grow as an individual. He wants me to grow as a person. He wants me to not simply remain as I always have been up to this point. Have you ever met one of those people who is in their 40s and is still living in their parents' basement and is still, you know, spends most of their day, like, not doing anything of value or of importance? What have you just witnessed in that sort of interaction? You have just witnessed a person who does not grow. We look at that and we kind of know that there's something wrong with that, but we may not exactly have a full understanding of why there's something wrong with that. Well, the reality is, because God has designed that person for growth, and they are not growing. Just as God has designed you and I for growth. And there are times when we kick against that reality, aren't there? There are moments where I refuse to grow. Where I have received that seed. Well, I'm just kind of set it aside over there for later. I'm busy digesting this right now. No, you were made for growth. You were designed by God to grow. And we have to receive the word. We have to receive what Jesus says to us to enable designed for us to grow. So there's the personal dimension of growth, but there are other dimensions of growth also, because it's not just about private and internal, is it? It's also about the corporate reality of there is this church that God has ordained, his people throughout time, throughout the ages, and if this is a local contemporary expression of that, and God desires his churches to grow and to develop. And sometimes that means, hey, look, there's more people here. But sometimes that also means, look what the people who have been here for a long time, look how mature they are. Look how unafraid they are of what the world is throwing at them. Look how unterrified they are by the situations that the world thinks makes it run the world. No, there are developments that are church-wide. Look how well these people worship. Look how well these people give. Look how well these people love one another. Look how well these people have rejected fear and have embraced the love of God. There are ways in which we as a church are meant to develop, to grow, to become more than what we were yesterday. Today doesn't have to be like yesterday was. Personally, individually, but also corporately as a church. And it all starts with planting. It all starts with planting. Jesus says, it's like a man who scatters the seed. Jesus is about the scattering seed. Jesus is this planter. You are the soil. You are that soil which receives the seed. Are you receiving the seed today? Individually, corporately, are we receiving the seed? Are we all on the same page? Jesus plants in each of us. He plants in us corporately as well. God's heart is committed to fulfill his promises and purposes for growth. God doesn't just say, ah, that person's not going to grow. I guess they're just a lost cause. He doesn't do that. And what the scripture actually says at another point in the book of Philippians in chapter 1 is that the writer of that passage says, I am sure that he who began a good work in you will be faithful to complete it on the day of Jesus Christ. Which means there is this reality that God has started something in each of us. God has a heart for growth for each of us and all of us together. And he will be faithful to continually chip away at the hardness of our hearts, at the foolishness of our actions and choices, and to direct us and course correct us to the way in which he desires us to be and to live. God has made you to grow. He has designed each of you individually for growth. He does not desire to leave you as you are now. Does God accept us as we are? Of course he does, but he refuses to leave us as we are. He absolutely refuses that. Why? Because he has a heart for growth. He's a great farmer. He tills the soil. He gives all sorts of nourishment. He allows the sun to shine. He fertilizes the ground. He brushes away and removes the rocks. He does whatever he can to make sure that growth happens. He's an excellent farmer. But there are some times when the soil just kind of goes, nah, thanks. No thanks. But God's heart is committed. God's heart is committed. Is yours? Is your heart committed to growth? Where are you in this today? To have the heart of God, you must delay gratification and imagine God will do better than you expect. To have the heart of God, you must delay gratification and believe that God will do better than you expect. So growth requires the practice of delayed gratification. It's slow because God is not impatient as we are. Sometimes we get antsy. Like, why? very simply means this. Sometimes we just have to shut up and wait. We just sometimes have to shut up and wait. And go, okay, I can't force this to happen. I can't make this happen. God, I'm trusting on you for your timing to see this through to its completion. I want to grow now. I want to be past this problem now. And that heart for growth, that commitment to growth that God has in store for us is necessary. But if we turn it into, I'm forcing this growth to happen, what we're going to find is frustration. Remain committed, but delay gratification. We have a huge problem with delayed gratification in our culture. We are so instant in our desires being fulfilled in so many ways that we don't get this idea that growth has to come slowly. If you look at the parable, it says that the farmer sleeps at night. He gets up, and it's a day and night. He gets up, and he's really not almost doing anything. But that growth, it just happens by itself. Continue doing the fertilizing, continuing to allow that seed to be planted. That's all good. That's all necessary. But you can't force it to grow. You can't force it to grow. You can't force yourself individually, personally to grow. We can't force the church to grow. We can make sure that there aren't rocks and weeds and stuff like that. But we can't force growth, personal or otherwise. It says, at first it sprouts. And then there's a thing that comes out of the ground. And then there comes this little bud, and then that bud opens up into the full ear, and he's talking about wheat here in the parable. But if you really think about how long that takes, the farmer can't go out there and go, come on, grow faster! You don't shout at it and it grows better, right? Okay? You don't stomp your fist at the ground, come on, produce! It doesn't work that way. It's slow. Sometimes excruciatingly slow. God's heart for growth is also his heart for patience for that growth. God is very patient with us. God is very patient with us. And sometimes I think we get this false image of God up there with his arms crossed, foot tapping, going, you guys, you're not growing fast enough. No, it's not that. It's wait, it's coming. Give it time. Patience. Patience. Wait, it's coming. And he says, the parable says, this happens all by itself. With the condition of the soil as it should be, with the condition of the seeds being planted as they should be, with the normal conditions for growth as they should be, the growth happens by itself. It is not forced, it is not pushed, it is not prodded, it is not cajoled, it happens by itself. And all of those things need to be as they should be. The growth factors, the soil has to be the seed has to be good seed, okay? Fertilizer, all that has to be, the sun's got to shine, God makes sure that happens, right? But it happens by itself. It can't be forced. It cannot be forced. Growth requires cultivating imagination and creativity for believing God. This is the soil conditions. These are the soil conditions. God has given us everything. Everything we need. Everything we need, God has given to us. God has given us all of the proper conditions. God has given us all of the proper soil conditions, all of the proper fertilizer. He's given us the proper seed. We have everything we need. Everything we need. The response of belief is the only thing you really contribute. The only thing you contribute. Belief. And even that is a gift from God. Even that is something He enables you to have. You know, it's not like you muster up the strength to believe. Scripture says, for it is God who works in you to will and to do according to His desire. God even gives you the will, the belief, to accomplish what He has called us to do, the ways He has called us to grow. And that seed grows slow sometimes. But here's the other reality. You take a seed, it's this tiny little thing, right? Just this insignificant, tiny little thing. Hardly looks like anything at all. Just, what is the seed? It's just, what is that? Toss it in the ground, plant it. But that seed contains all of the DNA of what becomes that larger plant. Think about the parable that we read for the scripture reading earlier before during the offering. The mustard seed, what does Jesus say about the mustard seed? He says it's the smallest of all of the seeds of the garden plants. It's the tiniest little, most insignificant thing. But when it's planted and it grows, it becomes the largest of all of the garden plants. God has planted His seed in you, and it may look tiny, and it may look insignificant, and it may look like, man, this thing is taking forever to grow. But when that thing sprouts, boy, watch out. Its branches go everywhere. It just even allows birds to perch on it. This thing is so big. This is the kingdom of God, and this is what kingdom growth is like. It begins and it looks so small and it looks so easy to defeat. But once that thing gets going, man, there's no stopping it. There's no stopping it. God has a heart for growth for you, for me, for all of us together. God has a heart for growth. So to have the heart of God means to have a heart for growth, which means patience, which means creativity, which means cultivating imagination for belief. Some questions and then an action step. If kingdom growth is not apparent today, is it because God's not displaying it or because we're not? If kingdom growth is not apparent or obvious today, is it because God's not displaying it or because we're not? Just chew on that. What can we become in response to the God whose heart is committed to His kingdom and His people? Think about that mustard seed. It looks small, it looks insignificant, and some of you may have that opinion of yourself. I don't have anything to offer. I got nothing. My life's messed up. No. Stop. Because that seed that God has planted in you in this moment, through His word, God has planted a seed in your heart. And that thing is not going to be able to be stopped once it starts growing. What can we become in response to the God whose heart is committed to His kingdom and His people? There's an action step. Seek growth within the kingdom by delaying gratification and imagine God will do better than you expect. Pray. God, we thank You for Your grace, Your amazing grace over us. We thank You for the growth that You plan for us. And we don't always see it. We don't always know what's coming and what it's going to look like when it gets God, for hearts that will set aside immediate gratification and instant desires and me-centeredness so that we might simply believe you and receive the growth at your schedule, on your pace that you have for us. We pray, God, that we will set aside all of the overexertions and the foolishness that we get up to as we try to make ourselves better and grow and simply receive through belief the growth that you have for us, because you have a heart for growth. But we desire that heart.